Today's text from this passage predominantly speaks about money. Let's face it. It speaks about money and those who have fallen in love with money. The love of money is what? That's right. It results in all kinds of evil. And James brings that reality to focus. Now, I have never been rich. Have you? I have never been rich. Not in this world's goods have I not been rich, but I've been rich in spiritual blessings and in things like that, but not in this world's goods. And I don't ever expect to be rich. Now, unless something should happen that I don't know about. But if I were rich, I would want somebody to hold me accountable, like James. He's holding us accountable. Maybe you're listening right now and you're rich. You need to listen, because James speaks as the voice of God for us, as he's anointed by the Lord. After all, money is nothing more than a tool. It is a means to an end in some situations, but it's not to be the end in itself. Never, never. Now, in the preceding verses of chapter 4 of James, he talks about those believers that were wealthy, Jewish believers, but got caught up and got off track a little bit. The Jewish merchants in those days would follow people where the action was, and they would set up shop, and they would sell their wares, and they would make a lot of money. That's what they did. That's why James says, hey, don't do that. Don't trust in uncertain riches. And don't you say that I have enough. Who knows that you're going to have enough? Now, in the preceding verses of James chapter 4, verse 13, we need to take heed to this warning. No doubt, money can make someone make someone a slave. Money can make you a slave. Almost like an addiction. I need more. I need more. Just a little bit more. I think a Rockefeller said, one more dollar. Just one more dollar. That's sad, isn't it? I went to a conference with Pam several years ago now, a dozen years ago. And it was a Mennonite conference out there in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. And they were having a conference on finances and our accountability to God for all of the finances he gives us. And the one message that really struck home to me, in fact, it was really only one sentence. It was this: when is enough enough? How much more do we need? When is enough enough? You may say one answer to that, and God would probably give you another answer to that for sure. I admire those who are faithfully using their money for the good of others and for the promotion of the gospel of Jesus Christ and wherever it goes to. They are to be admired. But I pity those who have fallen in love with money. It's so sad, so sad. They do not master their money. No, they don't. They think they master their money, but their money masters them. How do I know that? Well, they become slaves. Romans chapter 6 says, we are slaves to that which has control over us. We think we have the control of the money in our lives, but if we're not careful, it's going to take possession and have control over us. It becomes the boss. We become the slave. Slavery to money results in a whole bunch of bad stuff. Insecurity, because we can potentially lose everything. And we know that. Even those who are rich know that they can lose everything. The stock market crashes and so on and so forth. So there's an insecurity there. Anxiety is another thing that it causes, because we're thinking more about our possessions than we are about people. We're thinking more about our possessions than we are about the things that really matter to God, important in this world of ours. Also, slavery to money results in a loss of sleep. You think, Well, so what? That's important. How many of you have trouble sleeping? Loss of sleep, because a person that is in love with money, they're worried. They're pressured. They're under a lot of stress. And that can cause a loss of sleep or a financial concern. And a person who loves money can become very ungrateful because we are not trusting God any longer. We're trusting in our own ability to make wealth. And that doesn't always turn out right. And so we get angry. We get angry, upset. We're upset at other people maybe because they didn't pull their weight. Upset at the economy, so on and so forth. The Bible says this. God gives us the ability to produce wealth. Did you know that? It says that in the scripture. God gives us the ability to produce wealth. Well, that's so true, and some of us have that ability almost as a gift. But slavery to money causes disillusionment because we are tempted to use money to fulfill our dreams. And God never gave us those dreams. God never gave us those dreams. We find out it doesn't work. We become disillusioned. It's sad. It's really sad when you think about it. It's not something to be admired. Today I want to preach on, as you probably guessed, the subject of money. Because in this wonderful book we have, we're going through, this is called Rooted. And in chapter 8, it speaks about the importance of money. Money is very important. It's important to us. It's important to God. And the scriptures teach a lot about money. And so did Jesus Christ preach a lot about money. But here we acknowledge from James some sharp warnings addressing the need to make sure that we're good stewards of what God has given us. Now, I want to talk about, instead of all the negative stuff that I've just mentioned to you, to shift a gear now and talk about some positive things concerning money. What is it meant for? Think about it. We've had money since the beginning of time. I mean, they would trade chickens or I don't know, jewels or livestock or whatever they had. Money was involved. In Matthew, chapter 6, it talks about the fact that money is meant to provide for our needs. Provide for our needs. It says in Matthew 6, 26 and 27, Jesus is speaking, "Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor do they gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? And which of you by worrying can add one inch to your stature?" Well, the Lord never promised that he would provide the latest smartphone. How many of you listening buy a new phone every year? There are some that do. And they spend $1,000 doing it. It's sad. It's really unnecessary. Unnecessary. Or an electric car. Electric cars. That sort of fascinates me. And I have a silent wish in my life, maybe, that before I leave this world, I'd like to have an electric car. But I don't have one now, and I'm not trying to get one. If it should fall into my lap, I'll use it. Entertainment systems, you know, all these toys that we can gather together and accumulate so that we don't even have room enough to store them, or going all over the world every single year of our lives and travel. Those things are good. But we are not to put our trust in them. We are to put our trust in God for our basic needs. Our basic needs. Luke 12, verse 15. And Jesus said to them, "Be warned and be on guard against greed, for one's life does not consist of the abundance that he possesses." Now, God promised that he would provide our basic needs. But most things today, if you really think about it, are not basic needs. Are they? I don't know. We'd have to go over a list, a shopping list of things, I guess, and check it off if they're a basic need or not. But the last two or three generations have been taught not to live within their means. And they want more and more and more. This country is that way. We are in debt, $24 trillion. I can't even fathom that. It's just a measure of money to me. I can't understand how much money that is. $24 trillion in debt. Who's going to pay the piper someday? Who's going to pay the bill? I guess our children and grandchildren. Or the country will go completely bankrupt, like some do. The people in charge of products of the give me generation are now in charge of our government. They're running our government. And I'm not talking so much to our president. He's an older generation, but younger than he is. They're in charge of many things in this country of ours. It would be interesting to spend an entire week examining what I said a moment ago, this shopping list. Examine the shopping list and how much we really need those things. Most of them are non-essential. Jesus prayed, give us this day, our daily bread. That's a basic need. He didn't pray, give us the latest or the best or the most exciting, the newest. Especially the things that everyone else has. That's sinful, isn't it? That's a sinfulness to the core. Secondly, money teaches us to provide direction in our life. In Psalm 37:7, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Don't worry about others who are rich. Don't worry about others who are rich. Don't want to be like them. They have their problems. I remember in the 90s, in the church that I was pastoring at that time, we had more money than we needed. You know what? It caused problems, even in a church. Money can cause problems, especially excessive finances like that. It's very difficult. So why in the world should we envy rich people? Boy, how would you like to be like them? If we spend money we do not have on things we do not need, to please people we do not like, we're not going to be able to complete the call of God in our life. Because our attention is going to be on those things, and those people, and ourselves, and not on God's purpose for our life. The Lord wants to give us direction. He's going to protect us. Protect us from bad financial decisions. James says in another place, in chapter 1, I believe it is, pray for wisdom. Pray for wisdom on how to use your money. He also says that money is going to teach us patience. This is all in James. It's going to teach us faith and trust in God's provisions. Money is going to help us, and that's what it's meant to do, to properly manage our lives and our resources. By biblical principles, not our own, or get-rich-quick schemes and all of that kind of thing. All of these things, see, money can be a precious thing. If it's used right, if it's used as a tool, if it's constantly in movement, then it could be a great testimony for those who look on and say, wow, that person seems to have their life together. They're managing their money properly. They're not greedy. They're more giving than they are greedy. Thirdly, money is meant for us to learn the secret to giving. Giving. In Malachi chapter 3, verses 8 through 10. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me, says the Lord. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse. The Lord can say what he wants to say, right? And he's always right. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even the whole nation of Israel. And then he goes on, he tells them what to do if they want to correct this. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Why? Because God wants to help other people. God wants us to help other people. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. And this is, he says, test me. Test me. And this is the test. If you do what I say to do, see whether or not I open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive it. Now, let's say, well, Pastor, you don't know how destitute things I've been lately, and I've been hurting. You know, we don't have enough money. You have a tithe. You have a tithe. You make $100 a week. Most everybody makes more than $100 a week. Then give $10. To the ministry of God. Now, you would say, well, I need that $10. You see, you're testing the Lord then. You tie that $10. You're obedient to God's word, and don't you think for a moment that he's going to perform miracles for you along the way? He will perform miracles. If we don't do his word, then he's not going to perform miracles. It says it right here. In the scripture, Jesus said, it's better to give than to receive. Do you like to give? Then you have the Spirit of Christ resting upon you. And Jesus was the best example of giving. He wasn't concerned about whether there was enough money in his sack, you know, and whatever he put it in. He knew that his Father in heaven would provide the money he needed. In fact, remember, when the Jews asked about paying Caesar his tax, Jesus told one of his disciples to go down and get a fish. And in that fish's mouth was a coin to pay for the tax. I mean, come on. God is going to provide. God is going to provide. In the early church, Paul urged the Gentile believers to give to the Jewish believers. Oh, Gentile believer, the goyim. To give to the Jews. And they would maybe naturally think, why should we, the way that they treat us? They hate us. Why should we give anything to them? Paul says to the church, you Gentile believers, the Jewish believers in Israel and Jerusalem need your help right now. And they gave. They gave generously. And the result, the act of love that they had shown through their giving, tore down walls between the Jews and the Gentiles. It tore down walls and separated them for so many centuries. Now, in the early church, we read about the fact that believers gave according to the necessity of people. It was almost like a communal thing that was going on there. Everybody was taken care of. Now, that's difficult on a nationwide basis or even a statewide or a larger basis, but we as the church, when we know someone's in need, we need to try to meet that need. I think we can at least follow that example of the early church. And what did it do? People were looking at this group. They noticed that they took care of one another. In fact, one of the Romans reported in Josephus's account of the history of that time, he said, the Roman leader said, one thing that I do notice about those Christians, they seem to love one another. That wound up in secular history books, right on the spot there through Josephus. Now, some people have the gift of giving. The gift of giving. They don't like to hold on to anything too long. They want to give it away. Romans 12 speaks about that gift. But though they may have the gift, we have the commandment from God to give, not always be on the receiving end of things. Fourthly, what does money do? To illustrate God's power. I touched on that already. in Rome, rather in Acts 5, 12 through 14. Now, the context here is that the people had already in that early church given to one another and taken care of the needs of each, and everybody's watching, and it goes on to say, and through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people. But it started with them taking care of each other. Many wonders and signs were done among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. The people esteemed them highly. The people of Jerusalem esteemed them highly, and believers were increasingly added to the Lord, and multitudes of both men and women. We read another place daily. So as we trust in the Lord for our provision and prayerfully manage our money according to biblical principles, others, it says here in Scripture, are going to sit up and take notice. They're going to respond in a positive way to the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's an amazing thing. Money can be a good thing if it's used properly. It really can. There's nothing more contagious, you might say, than for a non-Christian to witness the joy that Christians have through their struggles as well. And yet they seem to notice that those Christians come out with a smile on their face. Some others don't. Some others don't. The Christians will excel spiritually. They will excel relationally, socially, and financially. Such a Christian will attract many to Christ. That's for sure. Now, God has turned your life around, I trust. God has turned your life around. Absolutely. He has turned all of our lives around. He has impacted our life to bring about change. Money is something that is a litmus test. If God changes your heart in the area of finance, you know, he's really on target. He's really working in a powerful way. And we would do ourselves a great favor to manage our money according to the biblical principles. I've told you this before. Maybe I have it right in here. Yes, I do. I'm looking at it, I believe. I have a book. It's about an inch and a half thick with illustrations. I'm talking about pictorial illustrations and everything that teach about what the Bible says concerning finance. It says a lot. We need to learn what it says. Those principles are eternal. Well, I shouldn't say eternal. They are generational. Let me put it that way. Right? When we get to heaven, I don't think there'll be any such thing as money anymore. But here in this world, there is. And we must pray about anything so important as our money that God has given us.